Alors c'est un grand plaisir d'accueillir pour ce premier séminaire Nathalie Piquet. Nathalie, on se connaît depuis assez longtemps, c'est vraiment une des meilleures spécialistes au niveau mondial de tout ce qui est spectroscopie de haute résolution et de ses applications à d'autres disciplines. Je pense à la métrologie, je pense à la chimie, je pense à la biologie. Tu vas peut-être nous parler de tout ça aujourd'hui ou d'une partie. En quelques mots, la carrière de Nathalie, elle a commencé sa thèse en France. Vous allez voir, elle est maintenant expatriée, mais ça fait partie des expatriés qu'on est content de faire revenir de temps en temps. Donc, elle a commencé sa thèse en France. Elle a soutenu sa thèse à Orsay en 1998. C'était au laboratoire de physique moléculaire. Elle a fait un postdoc au LENS à Florence. Et puis ensuite, elle a été recrutée au CNRS, au laboratoire de photophysique moléculaire, donc toujours à Orsay. Et en 2008, je crois que c'est là que tu as commencé une collaboration étroite avec Max Planck de Garching, en particulier l'équipe de Ted Hensch, et tu es devenu senior scientist là-bas, et elle est restée à Garching depuis toutes ces années, jusqu'à l'année dernière, où elle a eu un poste donc, de directeur du Max Born, c'est pas Max Planck, mais c'est le Max Born Institute for Nonlinear Optics and Ultrafast Spectroscopy à Berlin, et en même temps un poste de professeur à Berlin à l'université Humboldt, bravo. Comme je disais, Nathalie est travaille sur de multiples aspects de la spectroscopie à haute résolution. Un des thèmes peut-être les plus spectaculaires, ce pourquoi elle est le plus connue, c'est la méthode du double peigne de fréquence. Je suis sûr que vous allez en savoir plus dans un instant. Ça permet des mesures avec une très grande précision et aussi une grande vitesse d'acquisition dans plein de domaines. Alors moi, j'ai noté évidemment la spectroscopie, mais aussi l'holographie, l'imagerie. Je ne sais pas si tu vas parler d'autres choses encore, mais en tout cas, c'est une technique absolument fantastique. Je ne vais pas citer tous les prix qu'elle a obtenus, je vais peut-être en citer trois, un pour 2021, un pour 2022, un pour 2023, pour 2024 c'est pas encore sorti. Pour 2021 c'était le prix Gentner-Kassler, le prix conjoint société française de physique, société allemande de physique. Le prix en 2022, enfin un des prix en 2022, c'était le prix de la fondation Falling Walls, les murs qui tombent, le prix Breakthrough of the Year dans les sciences physiques. Et puis en 2023, c'était le grand prix Cécile de Witt-Morette, pardon, le prix des Ouches, de l'école des Ouches, décerné par l'Académie des sciences. Voilà. Nathalie, je suis très heureux de te laisser la parole. Voilà.
Toi de jouer. Merci beaucoup, Jean. Merci beaucoup pour cette introduction très, très flatteuse. Je suis vraiment très, très touchée de l'invitation. Je suis très heureuse de pouvoir être ici. Hier, j'ai passé la journée à visiter des manips, à avoir un nouveau contact avec des tas de gens que je n'avais pas vus depuis très longtemps. Et j'ai trouvé que c'était très stimulant. En fait, je trouve que mon séjour est trop court et je regrette de ne pas, rester plus longtemps. Donc, c'est le signe que ça se passe bien. Et je suis vraiment très impressionnée par tous les talents que j'ai rencontrés hier dans les locaux du laboratoire Kassler-Brossel. Alors, Jean m'avait demandé si je voulais faire mon exposé en français ou en anglais. Je me suis dit, le français, c'est une bonne occasion, mais j'ai eu un peu peur, parce que ça fait très longtemps que je ne parle plus le français pour les exposés scientifiques. Et donc, je vais donner l'exposé en anglais. Mais ne vous inquiétez pas, l'accent français, lui, est intégral et restera là, donc vous n'aurez pas de problème à me comprendre. And so now I'm switching to English. And what I will speak about in this talk is the field that now we call Frequenticum Interferometry. So that's a research field which has started a bit more than 20 years ago. Initially, it was involving only a couple of groups. It was not very. It took some time to emerge. Nowadays, I'm aware of more than 250 groups who are contributing very original development. So it has become a very active field. So in frequenticum interferometry, there is frequenticum. So let me first give a reminder about what a frequenticum is. Most of the time, a frequenticum is generated using an ultra-short pulse mode-lock laser. So what is it? Well, that's, first of all, a laser which emits ultra-short pulses. And if one has one pulse of such a laser, that one analyzes this pulse in a spectrometer, one gets a spectrum which is extremely broad. The span is inversely proportional to the pulse duration, and the spectrum is a kind of continuum. If we now allow two pulses to interfere in the spectrometer, one still has a very broad spectrum, but because of the interference between the two pulses, the envelope of the spectrum is now modulated by a sine wave. And one can show with a very simple Fourier analysis that the period in the frequency domain of this modulation is inversely proportional to the time duration between the pulses. If we now allow many pulses to interfere in a high-resolution spectrometer, the sine wave will thin out, and the spectrum is made of evenly spaced narrow laser lines, which are separated by the pulse repetition frequency, by the inverse of the pulse period. And that's the spectrum that we call the frequency comb. But this is only possible if there is a very precise timing of the waveform at the So this is only possible if the waveforms at the output of the lasers are very precisely controlled. If they are not precisely controlled, if one allows for small random fluctuations, like it is the case at the output of a traditional ultra-fast laser, as it is used for in chemistry, for dynamic measurement and things like that, the structure of evenly spaced narrow laser line is scrambled out, and one is back to a spectrum which is a kind of continuum. And so the frequency comb was made possible because people who had experience in frequency metrology, in laser stabilization, got interested into this ultra-short pulse laser, which were the tool for people who, in principle, were working in a totally different field. And for the rest of my talk, it's enough that you remember that a frequency comb is a spectrum which spans over a very broad spectral domain and which is made of evenly spaced narrow laser lines which are phase coherent. So these laser lines are separated by the pulse repetition frequency. And what is remarkable about this spectrum is that the absolute frequency of any of these laser lines can be written using this very simple relationship. So in this relationship, M is an integer, F rep is the line spacing between the comb lines, so that's the pulse repetition frequency. And it turns out that one can show that these frequencies are not harmonic multiple of the repetition frequency. There is a translation factor that we call carrier envelope of set frequency, which comes, for instance, from the fact that in a Modlock laser cavity, there is dispersion in the cavity, and so the phase and the group velocity do not match. This translation factor is something which has been difficult to measure, but nowadays, that's something which is well understood and that one knows very well how to measure and control. And what is remarkable about this simple equation is that it directly links optical frequencies, so which are typically lying at several hundreds of terahertz, so that frequency that one does not know how to directly count because they are much too fast. So it links optical frequencies to two radio frequencies. So the repetition frequency, the line spacing of the comb, that's typically the inverse of the cavity, of the laser cavity round trip. So that's typically something which is a few hundreds of megahertz. And the carrier envelope of cette frequency can have any value between zero and the repetition frequency. So we have two radio frequencies. And so that's the first tool which has enabled to make a direct link between optical and radio frequencies. As a consequence, one can directly measure the repetition frequency and the carrier envelope of set frequency. One can control them, compare them, for instance, to our primary standard of time and frequency, which is the cesium clock, and use this to deduce the optical frequency of any of the comb lines. So this is a tool which has enabled a revolution in the field of frequency metrology. And in this field, the frequency comb is used as a frequency ruler. So for its original purpose, frequency metrology, here is a sketch which simplifies the way a frequency comb is used. So in frequency metrology, in general, one wants to measure an optical transition as precisely and as accurately as possible. A simplified way of doing this is to have a CW laser of a very narrow line width, which will interrogate the atomic or molecular transitions that one would like to analyze. And then, in order to make an absolute frequency measurement, one needs to determine the absolute frequency of this laser. And so it means to compare it to a cesium clock. And the frequency comb with a tiny tabletop setup makes it possible because one can interfere, one can beat the CW laser with the frequency comb. And in the frequency domain, it means that when we have the frequency of the CW laser, beating with, of course, all the comb lines, but with a photodetector of the right bandwidth, one can measure the bit note between the CW laser and the most neighboring comb line. So that's a quantity which will lie again in the radio frequency domain that one can count very precisely. And provided that one knows the order of the comb line with which it is beating, so this factor n, then by the measurement of the bit note between the CW laser and the comb line, one can deduce the absolute frequency of the CW laser. And so there are tricks which enable to determine which comb line one is beating with in a rather straightforward manner. And these developments have been done at the end of the 1990s, initially at the Max Planck Institute for Quantum Optics in Garching. And this has been really a revolution in the field of frequency metrology. And nowadays, these frequency combs that in our jargon, we call them frequency rulers, they are commercially available. And most of the all the national metrology institutes in all countries are now equipped with such frequency combs, and as well as a number of groups who are interested in precise frequency measurement. But from the early development of the frequency combs, so they demonstrated their full power for frequency metrology at the end of the 90s. They made possible frequency measurement and precision spectroscopy. And starting from this, they have found a growing tree of applications because there are a lot of people from different fields who found that this kind of spectra with a very high resolution structure could be, and a very broad span, could be interested for their applications. And so this slide shows some of the applications. For instance, frequency combs have become key to optical clocks because they also enable to make precise optical frequency comparisons. They have been also, by the possibility to measure the carrier envelope offset and to control the carrier envelope offset of ultra-short pulses, they have been key to attosecond science. That's partly due to frequency combs that one can generate attosecond pulses. And they have found a number of other applications they are, for instance, very useful for calibrating astronomical spectrographs which are looking for exoplanets, and especially Earth-like exoplanets. And one of these new applications is the field to which I have been contributing. It is what we nowadays call direct frequency comb spectroscopy. So what is direct frequency comb spectroscopy? Well, that's again a very simplified slide which shows the simplest experiment of direct frequency comb spectroscopy. The direct comes from the fact that now the frequency comb is the light source the frequency comb generator is the light source which interacts with the sample. And so for the simplest experiment, one can have an absorbing sample, and one simply transmits the frequency comb through the sample, and behind one has a very broad spectrum, so one needs a spectrometer in order to analyze the light, and one can measure the spectrum of the frequency comb with the imprint of the transitions of the sample. And so that's the idea is to do so very broad band spectroscopy. So that's something which benefits mostly to spectroscopy of molecules, because usually molecules have spectra which are very dense and very crowded. And provided that one is able to resolve the individual comb lines, one will get a spectrum which is directly which has a frequency scale which is directly calibrated. So the first experiment around this principle have been performed in 2004-2005. But it was really a very proof of principle experiment, and it has taken a lot of time to develop this experiment. And the reasons were that, first, the light sources, which are interesting for this type of spectroscopy, need to be fit to the type of spectroscopy that one is doing. For instance, if one wants to do molecular spectroscopy, that's interesting to have frequency combs in the mid-infrared spectral region, which is called the molecular fingerprint region because a lot of molecules have strong rotational and vibrational lines, or to have frequency combs emitting in the ultraviolet range where there are electronic transitions in molecules. So 15-20 years ago, these light sources did not exist. So there have been really a lot of efforts from people involved in laser technology to develop frequency comb technology outside the near-infrared region where the instrumentation is conveniently available. Another difficulty has been to find out what were the spectrometers which were able to really demonstrate all the potential of this type of spectroscopy. And so one needs a spectrometer which is able to analyze over a broad span in order to analyze the entire span of the frequency comb, but which has also a very high resolution because one would like to resolve the individual comb lines. And so initially, people have worked with existing spectrometers. We were the first to show that the performance of the Fourier transform of the Michelson-based Fourier transform spectrometer are greatly improved in terms of sensitivity, of precision and accuracy, and of measurement time, simply by adding frequency comb source in front of the spectrometer. Others have demonstrated, others like Junier, have demonstrated that the same for dispersive or grating spectrometers. But the technique has become more interesting when we have started to develop a new type of spectrometer, which is totally enabled by the frequency comb, and which is what is now called the dual comb spectrometer. And so I'm now going to explain what is this dual comb thing. And so again, I have a very simple scheme which sketches how a dual comb spectrometer may look like. So that's now we have two frequency combs, so typically two mode-lock lasers which are stabilized in the appropriate manner. And these two mode-lock lasers emit pulses at slightly different pulse repetition frequency. So it means in the spectral domain, the two spectra have slightly different line spacing. In the simplest experiment that one can think about, one may want again to do linear absorption spectroscopy. So at least one of the combs interacts with the sample, which is here some molecules in the gas phase which are in a cell. And then we combine the two combs on a beam splitter. and they interfere on a fast photo detector. And our recording consists in measuring this interference signal as a function of time. So I'm going to explain why, from this measurement, it's possible to get a spectrum. But first, I would like to make three very simple comments about this setup. So the first comment is actually what's written here. That's a setup which has no moving part. That's purely static. The second comment is that's a setup which only uses a single photodetector. So all the spectral elements are simultaneously measured on a single photodetector. That's a technique of Fourier spectroscopy. That's interesting for several reasons. One being that the technique can work in any region, virtually in any spectral regions, provided that there are frequency comb sources emitting in this region. The third remark, I will come back to it towards the end of my talk, is that actually, in order to measure the signal, we need to form an interferometer between the two combs. We need to create coherence between the two trains of pulses. And actually, it means that in this type of experiment, we do actually interferometry between the two combs, and that this type of setup has mostly been of interest to scientists for spectroscopy. But actually, it can serve in essentially any setup which involves two beam interference. And I will show towards the end of my talk that there are other applications beyond spectroscopy. But let's go back to spectroscopy and let me explain why it's possible to measure a spectrum out of a setup like this. So that's a time domain technique. So in the time, so I'm starting to, I first explain it in the time domain. So in the time domain, we have the two combs and they have slightly different pulse repetition frequency. So one comb interacts with the sample. So behind the pulse, we have the free induction decay of the molecules or atoms in the sample. And because the two combs have a slightly different repetition frequency, everything is as if the pulses of one comb were walking through the pulses of the second comb. So from one pair of pulses to the next, the time delay in the pulse pair will automatically vary, but it varies in a purely static manner. There are no delay lines, no moving parts. And so when the pulses overlap, we have a strong interference signal. When they don't overlap, we have no interference signal. And that's this interference signal that we record, that's what we are interested in. Going a little bit more into the detail, so we have one comb which periodically excites the sample, so we have a repetitive waveform made of the pulse of the comb followed by the free induction decay of the molecular resonances. And so ideally, we would like to measure this free induction decay, but it's decaying very fast, so a photodetector is not fast enough to measure these oscillations. So what we do is that we use the second comb, which has a slightly different repetition frequency, so the second comb samples the initial waveform in an asynchronous manner. And so in this way, we are able to restitute the waveform of interest, but stretched in time, so that it becomes measurable by a standard photodiode. And one of the difficulties in doing this is that, of course, the relative fluctuations, the timing jitters between the pairs of pulses are also magnified in time. So one really needs to have very good control, one needs to have interferometric coherence between the pulses. And that's actually, technically, we did not know how to enforce really good interferometric coherence between the pairs of pulses, and that's something which has been taking a lot of time to explore several ways of doing this, and that's only rather recently that it has been fixed. So now I'm explaining this in the time domain, but for a spectroscopist, usually we speak in the frequency domain. And so it's perhaps more intuitive, at least to me, to explain this in the frequency domain. In the frequency domain, we have two combs, so the blue one and the red one, and they have slightly different line spacing. And these two combs are emitting in the optical region, so we do not know how to directly count their frequency, but we know very well how to control our comb, so we can control the relative positions of our comb in such a way that bit notes between pairs of comb lines, one of each comb, will interfere and will produce a third comb. And now this third comb is down-converted in the radio frequency region, where one knows very well how to count frequency. So in practice, we measure this radio frequency spectrum, and because we know very well all our comb parameters, we go back a posteriori to the optical scale. So that's how the technique works. This is the experimental signal that we measure as a function of time. So that's our time domain signal. So it's made of a succession of huge bursts which appear periodically, because as the difference in repetition frequency between the two lasers is a constant, the pulses of the two lasers will continuously walk through each other. And so, once every the inverse of the difference of the repetition frequency, the pulses will overlap and will do this periodically again and again. And so this strong burst or the periodic pulses overlap. And then, if we have an absorbing sample on the beam path, at the pedestal of this huge signal, we have a signal like this, which is not noise, that's very reproducible, and that's the signal that we are looking for. That's the signature of our absorbing sample. So in practice, what we do is that we measure this sequence as a function of time, and then we Fourier transform it. We use an harmonic tool, which is the Fourier transform, in order to get the spectrum. The longer the time domain sequence, the higher the spectral resolution. So this is an example of an absorption spectrum that we have been able to measure with the technique of dual comb spectroscopy. So we started to work on this before 2005, and actually we really got this absorption spectra, which for me really summarizes very well the benefits of dual comb spectroscopy, only 5 years ago. So it shows that it has been really involved to develop the sources and to learn how to control them. And so this absorption spectrum is in the mid-infrared spectral region, so that's interesting. That's a spectrum of the ethylene molecule, where we interrogate that's ethylene in the gas phase. We observe the transitions which are Doppler broadened, and that's raw vibrational lines, which correspond to the CH stretch. And the spectrum doesn't look like the normal absorption spectrum. It looks all black because we resolve the individual comb lines. So the absorption spectrum is sampled by the individual comb lines. And now I have a little animation in which we are going to zoom into this spectrum. Yeah, so these are the stretching modes which are excited. So we start to see that now there are some dips which comes from the absorption of our sample. And actually, the molecular spectrum is quite crowded. All these dips are transitions from the sample. And now we start to see the individual comb lines which are resolved. And so what is remarkable in this spectrum is that the frequency scale of the spectrum is directly calibrated within the accuracy of a cesium clock. So now we finish on this individual combline. When we saw this, we were actually rather happy. So you may think that the combline doesn't look very pretty with all these ringing things. But actually, as in the time domain, we measure over a finite measurement time. So we multiply our time domain signal by a boxcar. It means that in the frequency domain, we convolve by a cardinal sign. And this is this cardinal sign that we see. And actually, that we see it so well was actually rather satisfactory because it shows that really we control rather well our instrument. And so in this spectrum, we are able to resolve simultaneously 80,000 comblines over a measurement time of about half an hour that we chose because we were willing to get a good signal-to-noise ratio. Now, of course, I show this thing because that's this spectrum because that's always very impressive to see the individual comblines. But the spectral information about the sample is only contained at the maxima of the combline. So it's also possible to simply sample the spectrum at the combline position and to then get the traditional absorption spectrum, which looks like this one, where here you see all the dips that you see, or the transitions from ethylene, from the raw vibrational transitions of ethylene. And so one can see on this zoom that the transitions, so which are Doppler broadened, so a few hundreds of megahertz broad, are very well resolved with a good signal-to-noise ratio. And in the meantime, we are also able to measure the dispersion spectrum, the phase spectrum of the sample. And so when we reached this point, we have been wondering, well, what do we bring to molecular spectroscopy? We were rather pleased by the result. And so the first thing that we bring, I already told it, is the self-calibrated frequency scale. It means that we do not have to rely on transitions that would have been better measured by other techniques to calibrate our frequency scale. So this is something which is very useful and which is new for spectroscopy over a broad spectral bandwidth. In the meantime, also, we interrogate the transitions of our sample with very narrow laser lines. And it means that the response, the signature of the instrument, what we call the instrumental line shape, can be negligible, at least for Doppler-broadened transitions. It means essentially that we directly measure the spectral line shape of the transitions of the molecules. And this is very, very interesting for people who are studying spectral line shapes, because it means that we are able to measure not only the frequencies, not only the line positions, but all the line shape parameters with a much better precision than ever before. But still, when we have been trying to measure the absolute frequency of our transition, we found out that essentially we improve by one order of magnitude the accuracy of molecular spectroscopy. Well, that's something that one can appreciate. But on the other hand, we found out that we were limited by the statistical uncertainty of how well we can measure the line positions. Essentially, if one measures the position of a spectral line, of course, the broader the line and the worse the signal-to-noise ratio, the less precision one has in measuring the line position. And we found out that essentially, we are limited by this. So essentially, our transitions are too broad because they are Doppler-broadened. And our accuracy could be orders of magnitude better if one was willing to really take advantage of the frequency comb calibration. But at the moment, it's on the order of 10 to the minus 9, 10 to the minus 10 if one is a bit careful. So that's very good, but it doesn't make the most of the technique. And so when we reach this point, I've been wondering, well, is it all what we can get from this technique, which was already quite satisfactory, or are there other things? And then that's when I realized that actually I had overlooked and everybody in the community actually that there is a very fundamental difference of the dual comb spectrometer compared to any other spectrometer over a broad spectral bandwidth. And that so far all what had been done did not exploit this fundamental difference. And so what is this fundamental difference? Well, it is essentially that if we think about all the spectrometers which work over broad spectral bandwidth, so which can be Michelson interferometer, the Fourier transform spectrometer, grating, their resolving power can be expressed as a ratio of length, but the maximum path difference divided by the wavelength. And so as a consequence, the resolution is always limited by geometry. If one wants a high resolution, it means a bulky instrument. And at some point, the optical aberrations are such that it's not possible to indefinitely increase the resolving power. The dual comb interferometer relies on direct frequency measurement. One measures bit notes. And as a consequence, the resolving power is expressed as a function of a ratio of time, the maximum optical delay divided by the period of the vibration of the light, which means that actually that's the only spectrometer over a broad spectral bandwidth for which the resolution has no fundamental limit. It's only time. Of course, there are a lot of practical limits, but fundamentally, it's totally unlimited. And the span is also totally unlimited. And so, of course, the people who come from frequency metrology can see that it's already the idea which was well known in frequency metrology that for a very long time, up to the 90s, people were doing wavelength measurement with a wave meter, and they had their accuracy limited. And when people started to make heterodyne measurement by beating two lasers, there has been really a tremendous increase in the accuracy of the frequency measurement that one could do. This was for CW, for monochromatic light sources, so for the measurement at one frequency only. Here, with the dual comb interferometer, one can see it as a multi-heterodyne technique, which means that in practice, it's interesting to wonder how far can one push the accuracy? Can one really benefit from the fact that we are doing direct frequency measurement at a lot of frequencies simultaneously? And so that's now what we are trying to explore, what we are trying to exploit. And so in the remaining of this talk, I want to give three examples which show the direction that we are currently exploring to try to take advantage of this particular property. So, of course, the first idea is, can we push the accuracy of our measurement? Can we create a technique where we can do very accurate spectroscopy over a broad spectral bandwidth? So can we merge the advantages of frequency metrology together with that of broadband spectroscopy? So what are the motivations? What kind of physics can one dream about for this type of experiment? Well, the precise frequency measurement in simple atoms, and in particular in the very simple hydrogen atom, have been really one of the workhorse of frequency metrology. It has really tremendously improved our understanding of physics. I was actually very pleased yesterday that I could visit François Ney and Pauline Isombard and Lucille Julien, because they are part of the world leaders for the spectroscopy of atomic hydrogen. So it was very stimulating to see that to be in a place where at the laboratoire Kessler-Brossel, so many results have been obtained in precise frequency measurements of simple atoms. And as far as the spectroscopy of the hydrogen atom is involved, why is it so important? Well, I think the main reason is that it is the best way to benchmark quantum electrodynamics calculations. And these calculations have been pushed very far, up to 12 digits, and similarly has been pushed the spectroscopy of atomic hydrogen. So that's one of the reasons. And from the spectroscopy of atomic hydrogen, also, one can determine some fundamental constants, such as the Rydberg constant or the proton charge radius. And one can wonder, one can make measurements to see if the constants are really constant. And it was a situation which was very accepted until about 15 years ago, when in 2010, there has been a measurement of the proton charge radius in muonic hydrogen. So that's an hydrogen atom where the electron is replaced by a muon, which is 200 times heavier, which means that the proton charge radius can be measured much more precisely. And this measurement, in which the group at the laboratory Kassler-Brossel was involved, revealed that the proton charge radius derived from muonic hydrogen was 4% smaller than the one derived from traditional electronic hydrogen. And the error bars, the discrepancy, was more than 7 standard deviation. And so it has stimulated a lot of discussions in the community. Is it due to a theory, a dent in the theory, or are there some issues in the measurement? I think that's not totally settled, but now there have been new measurements in hydrogen which have been performed and which really very strongly suggest that the problem was a problem of estimating correctly the error bars in different spectroscopy measurements. And as a consequence, there has been the idea in the community that perhaps simply relying on hydrogen spectroscopy was not the right thing to do, and that one should wonder whether there would not be other simple systems which would help to provide independent tests of this type of things. And so to really illustrate the importance of this discrepancy in the proton charge radius, I can use this slide, which is a slide from Professor Hensch, which shows how the consequence for the Rydberg constant. In 2014, it was determined only using atomic hydrogen spectroscopy, and now taking into account the muonic hydrogen spectroscopy has significantly changed the value. And so therefore, we have the question, would it be possible to do very precise spectroscopy in very simple molecules? And in particular, could one use this thing for, well, essentially the same type of questions which are answered in atomic spectroscopy? And of course, there are already a lot of groups who are working with precise spectroscopy in small molecules. They do it by using the same tools as what is done for atomic spectroscopy, so essentially tunable variations. But I think this is becoming more and more relevant because the quality of the ab initio calculations, the precision of the ab initio calculation, has tremendously improved in the past 10 years. So that's a possibility. And so what is a simple molecule? When we are interested in molecular hydrogen, which is also one of the simplest molecules, and in particular in electronic transitions in molecular hydrogen. So the ground state of electronic hydrogen is already now well described by calculation at the 10 to the minus 10 level. And the group of Krzysztof Paczucki in Poland is now working towards extending their amazing calculation tools to this electronic transition. And so what we our goal is to reinvestigate these transitions and to try to push the precision. And so one of the challenges is that that's a transition which is a two-photon transition at 190 nanometers, so that's a deep ultraviolet range. That's difficult to access with frequency combs. And so far, only one transition has been observed with precise spectroscopy within an accuracy of 10 to the minus 11. So we are willing to reinvestigate this type of problems. And ideally, we would like to make the most of what molecular spectrum offers. So we would like to measure many, many transitions simultaneously. And for this, we need a tool which is able to provide a very high resolution, ideally close to the natural line width of the molecules, with a broad spectral bandwidth and with an extreme precision. And so how to get it all? Well, of course, we don't know for sure, but what we are exploring is to adapt dual-comb spectroscopy to this type of problems. And so, of course, there are a lot of challenges for this. One of the challenges is to improve the resolution of dual-comb spectroscopy. Here, I have transitioned the natural line width for three orders of magnitude narrower than the Doppler width of the transition that I showed before. So that's one of the challenges. Another challenge is to move the dual-comb technique into the deep UV range, which is more difficult to access experimentally. And finally, to check whether we can indeed perform precision spectroscopy. So we are addressing this challenge by making small steps. And the first thing that we wondered is, can we go beyond the Doppler width of the transition? Can we access Doppler-free spectroscopy? So in order to do Doppler-free spectroscopy, well, one possibility is to keep Doppler broadened spectroscopy, but to cool the molecules in order to have very narrow Doppler width. Another possibility is to cancel or to reduce the Doppler effect. So we have decided to explore the second option. And for this, we use two-photon spectroscopy. So two-photon spectroscopy with a CW laser, that's something which is well known and which has also been pioneered at the laboratory Kassler-Brossel by Bernard Cagnac and François Birabin in the 1970s for Doppler-free spectroscopy. So the idea is that if two photons are simultaneously absorbed, they can excite a two-photon transition. And one can measure with a very high sensitivity the signal by looking, for instance, at the fluorescence towards decay, towards to lower energy levels. Now, if the two photons come from two beams which are counter-propagating at the sample, the two beams will see the excited atoms or molecule which has a velocity component which will be equal in value but of opposite sign. And in this way, one can greatly cancel the Doppler effect. So that's a widespread technique of Doppler-free spectroscopy. And with frequency combs, it has already been used. Actually, it has been the very first application of a frequency comb back in the 1970s in the group of Theodor Hensch at a time where the frequency combs were not entirely stabilized. They were coming from picosecond laser. And the idea is that if one uses a comb to excite a two-photon transition, many pairs of comb lines will contribute to the excitation, so one can show that the excitation efficiency is the same as if one was using a CW laser of the same power. One can then observe also the signal of the excitation on a background-free technique like fluorescence, or one can further ionize the atom or molecule to have a lot of sensitivity. But a limit in this technique is that there is no spectrometer, so the spectrum is only measured modulo the repetition frequency. So it means that it's a technique which works only for very simple spectra, because otherwise all the transition will overlap. And so that's but that's interesting. That's still interesting, for instance, for ultraviolet spectroscopy, because in the ultraviolet spectroscopy there are no CW lasers directly emitting there. So to create the ultraviolet radiation, one has to rely on nonlinear frequency conversion of the laser, and one can get much better efficiency by using short pulse lasers. So that's a technique which is used by several groups, like the group of Junier or the group of Theodor Hensch in Garching, for very simple spectra. But simply, if one look at the very well-known and very simple transition 5S-5D of the simple rubidium atom, if one excites them and measure the excitation spectrum with a frequency comb, this is the spectrum that one measures. So the free spectral range is 100 MHz, which is the comb repetition frequency. And actually, if one look at the spectrum, that's actually the overlap of all these different spectra, which are in different spectral regions, neighboring regions, which are all overlap. So even for a simple atom like rubidium at room temperature, it's not a technique which is very powerful. So the idea is that we can use, again, our two-comb technique in order to excite the Doppler-free spectrum of atoms. And in doing so, we excite our two-photon transitions with two combs of slightly different repetition frequency. And in doing so, of course, we have still the advantage that many pairs of comb lines contribute, that we can work in the ultraviolet spectral region. But we have the additional advantage that if we express the excitation amplitude of the atom, it's now modulated by an interference term, which is directly proportional to an integer multiple the difference in repetition frequency between the two combs, which means that we can really identify in a totally unambiguous manner the transition that we have excited, and we can get their excitation spectrum with a free spectral range, which is now only limited by the emission of the frequency combs. So this is what we have been doing. So for doing this, what we do is that we have a sample which will emit fluorescence, and we have two counter-propagating beams at the sample, and the two combs are both counter-propagating at the sample. And we measure the fluorescence under this standing wave dual comb excitation. And this is the spectrum that we are able to get. So that's exactly the same spectrum as the one that I showed a few slides before. But now the spectrum is unfolded because we use the dual comb technique, so it's no longer aliased. And so previously, the span was 100 MHz. Here, it's a bit more than 100 GHz, but in reality, it was 10 terahertz. Here, I just show the region where there were excitation transitions. And now, so we measure this spectrum all at once, and we have narrow resonances, 6 MHz, that's limited by transit time broadening, and that's two orders of magnitude narrower than the Doppler transition. So now we are reinvestigating this spectrum to try to assess the systematic effects, to try to understand what is the accuracy that we can get. And that's interesting to do it in rubidium because that's a good test sample because it has been measured by really many, many techniques. In the meantime, we also want to move towards deeper here the transition were in the near ultraviolet, but we want to move deeper into the deep ultraviolet, and then we have a problem that we need to rely on nonlinear frequency conversion of near infrared combs. That's not a very efficient process. So we need to learn how to deal with very weak optical signals. And so we have also made a proof of principle experiment in which we have been willing to see how weak can be the signal. So we have on purpose generated very inefficient nonlinear frequency conversion in order to appreciate if we could learn how to handle the very low light level. And so we have attenuated our light so much that we went to the about 20 femtowatt level, average power, which means that essentially we need to rely on photon counting technology, and that we have one click every 2,000 laser pulses in general. And so here the challenge, so first for me it was not, it's well known, it has already been shown with CW laser by Mandel very long time ago, that one can still measure interference in these conditions where on average there is less than one photon in the interferometer. It was still not very intuitive to me. So I was doubtful until the experiment was starting to work. And what we do with the photon counting technique is that we really need to have a very stable interferometer so that we accumulate many scans so that we can reconstitute the statistics of the photon counting up to a point where we reconstitute our traditional time domain signal. And so I can show this on this little animation, which will show, as a function of accumulation time, how the interferogram builds up in the experiment. And then for the animation, we have in real time how the spectrums build up. And so initially, it really looks only as noise. And after some point, we start to see that there is a periodic structure which are the different repetition frequencies of our radio frequency comb, and we have a comb with nice lines which are appearing. And so this was obtained in the near ultraviolet region and under excitation condition where we have less than one femtowatt per comb line of average power. So this is a one-over test which tells us that there is hope that we can really work in the deep ultraviolet under very low efficiency conditions. In the meantime, we were happy to show that we are limited by the shot noise. Of course, that's expected at such low light level, but dual comb spectroscopy in general works at powers which are 1 billion fold stronger, typically milliwatt level, where one is in general limited by the intensity noise of the laser or the detector noise. And so it was also a way to show that there are procedures to have dual comb spectroscopy working also at the shot noise level. And this produces spectra which in the end look exactly like a traditional dual comb spectrum. So it was that's essentially a technological performance which shows that it's possible. And so we are really making little steps. Now we have radiation at 300 nanometers and we are trying to take advantage of this, but we don't have a result yet. But we are taking little steps to essentially answer all these questions and to try to find out how far we can push the accuracy of our dual comb spectroscopy. We are also learning how to work with samples which are much better conditioned. And ideally, at some point, we would like to work with single atoms or single molecules in order to work in a collision-free environment as well. And with this, perhaps we will be able to contribute to some tests of fundamental physics. So that's essentially our main motivation. If I can take the time, I have just two short examples that I would like to show, which just aim at illustrating that we can contribute to fundamental physics, but there is also some other funny wind-fold applications which are more applied. And one consequence that we make a pure time measurement is of course that we can have very high resolution, but an overconsequence is that our spectrometers can be extremely compact. We can have very high resolution while being extremely compact. And so the question is, how compact can we be? And could we have a broadband spectrometer at high resolution? Can we have a gas phase spectroscopy laboratory on a tiny little chip? And so that's one of the things that we are trying to explore. And so for this, we work in collaborations with groups who work in nanotechnology. And one of the results that I would like to highlight is some work that we do with the group of Bart Koiken at the University of Ghent, where that's a group who is expert in silicon nitride chip technology. And with them, we develop a Modlock laser on a chip. And so one such Modlock laser, that's a waveguide of silicon nitride. The cavity in our case is rather long, typically several centimeters, 3 centimeters, but it can be extremely compact because one can wrap the waveguide while having low losses. So this forms the cavity. It's ended by two Bragg retroreflector. And if we want to make a Modlock laser, we also need a gain medium and a saturable absorber. And this, we do it with semiconductors which are bonded on top of the silicon nitride waveguide. And with this, we fabricate a Modlock laser which has a footprint which is smaller than 1 square millimeter, which is battery operated, so it can work during hours on a battery, and it has a repetition frequency of 1 gigahertz. So this is how the chip looks like. So here, in this violet region, we have several Modlock lasers. We can zoom onto this chip. So for instance, we have one Modlock laser here, where the cavity starts here. Then here we have some aluminium contact in order to bring the electrical pumping from our battery. And then the waveguide to the gain medium. And then the waveguide continues here and is wrapped in this spiral. And so at the moment, we just have the lasers on chip, but we still have normal battery that we bring in the power, and the rest of the experiment is still on an optical table, so we are making little steps towards this. But we were already happy to show that in the telecommunication region, we can also get some new Holcomb spectra, which are of fairly high quality, and we can interrogate gas sample with a short measurement time and a good signal-to-noise ratio where we can distinguish between carbon 12 and carbon 13 in carbon monoxide gas. And so that's something which is more applied. And for this, the long-term vision that we have for this is that we could fabricate at the scale of the wafer many small dual-comb spectrometers. And that's an animation which is on scale. So we would have a lot of tiny dual-comb spectrometer. Each of these spectrometers would be very small compared to the size of a mobile phone. So perhaps in 10 or 20 years, you will all have a dual-comb spectrometer in your mobile phone. And it would be based on two Modlock lasers of slightly different repetition frequency, which are combined, then some protocols to interrogate the gas molecules, which can be, for instance, through evanescent sensing, through a waveguide, and a detector. And so that's something which derives exactly from the same technique, which is very applied, which has a lot of ramifications towards nanotechnology, which is fun, and which is something that we had not anticipated when we started this dual-comb spectroscopy. And finally, the last illustration that I would like to provide is, of course, there are other prospects. It's not limited to spectroscopy. Can one do other type of interferometry with this? So there are several groups who do very successfully LIDAR experiment with a dual-comb setup, and that's very powerful. In particular, there is a group at NIST ou really obtains very accurate results about this. More generally, if we take a bit of distance about what we have learned is we have learned how to control very well the timing jitters and the phase jitters between pairs of pulses. Very well is a sub-attosecond timing jitters, and that's really the state of the art for controlling pairs of pulses. So we are at the moment at the Max Born Institute in Berlin, where there is really a lot of attosecond groups. We are wondering whether we could bring something to new schemes of pump probe experiment, for instance, in the XUV, where of course very, very short time jitter matter. One other thing that we have done is add a new box to our evolutionary tree of the frequency comb, which is three-dimensional imaging. And of course, there are many techniques of three-dimensional imaging. One of these techniques is holography. And so we are doing, which is a technique of interferometry. And so we are now doing holography with a dual comb system. And so the way it works is that so we have two combs of slightly different repetition frequency. One comb is the object comb, which means that this comb will interrogate a three-dimensional object. And then the light, which is scattered by the object, so here the object is a coin, and so the light is scattered in reflection. The light which is scattered by the object is combined on a beam splitter with the light from a second comb of slightly different repetition frequency. And these two interfere on a detector matrix, so on a camera sensor. So that's using a camera sensor for holography is called digital holography, so that's no longer the old holography on film. Now the hologram is recorded on a camera sensor. And for our experiment, what we do is actually we record as a function of time the spatial pattern on each pixel of the camera. And in doing this, what we do is that actually we record as many holograms as we have comb lines. We have one hologram per comb line. So if we look into a single hologram, it looks like a traditional hologram, it doesn't tell much, but one can use existing reconstruction techniques in order to reconstruct the object, which are digital techniques. And for instance, here we have been reconstructing, we have two coins, which are not at the same position. So here the first coin is in focus, and now the second coin becomes in focus. So in doing this, we do exactly the same as we would do with a CW laser. It's just checking that it works. But what is interesting with the comb is that if we use all the comb lines, we can lift the ambiguity which exists in any interferometric technique, that distance measurement can be only done within half a wavelength. By using all the comb lines, we can lift this ambiguity and make a really absolute distance measurement in a much more precise manner. And so that's one of the aspects where having many comb lines is interesting. Another aspect is to do hyperspectral holography, so to simultaneously interrogate the spectral behavior of the sample while doing three-dimensional imaging. And so that's it was our first demonstration, and it was rather noisy. We are now working towards a better experiment where we actually also use frequency combs on chip. So we use micro-resonators. So that's a micro-ring which is made of a non-linear medium, which can be silicon nitride or lithium niobate, and which is pumped by a CW laser. And the micro-ring has a very high finesse, a very high Q factor, and so there are non-linear effects which are enhanced in this type of micro-rings, so that one can show that one can form a frequency comb by four-wave mixing, essentially. And so by injecting a CW laser in a micro-ring like this, one can get a frequency comb at the output. That's a field which is also very developed for more than 15 years. And what we don't do original development with the microcomb sources, but we try to find applications, and applications which take advantage of their large line spacing. And we very recently got some first results that will be presented at CLEO. So we can think that there is also a potential for holography. And again, we are asking a lot of questions. How far can we push the accuracy? And can we develop on-chip device? And so with this, I have reached the end of my talk. This topic of looking at interference between frequency comb, it's really started in a purely curiosity-driven way about 20 years ago. At that time, I had absolutely no idea. I had thought that it would keep me busy during a few years and then that I would have to find something else. I had absolutely no idea of all the potential which has revealed over the years. There are other topics we are working on that I have no time to do detail, which are summarized here. And what I really find fun is that from the same principle, the same layout, we are able to really think about addressing very fundamental questions of physics, and also perhaps to develop some new technology that will be of interest to more applied fields. And so with this, I would like to mention that all the work that I have reported on is done by my group members. That's a small group of very skilled and very motivated people. So I'm really grateful and lucky to work with them. And we have also very generous funders. I would like to thank you for your attention. And I can make a little bit of advertisement that we have positions for postdoc and students. And so if you are interested, don't hesitate to contact me. Thank you very much.